The Institute Presents on BCTV is supported by the Yocum Family Perpetual Charitable Trust.
Welcome to the Institute Presents. I'm Susan Rohn, the Executive Director, and my co-host today is Beverly Houck, the Artistic Director, who is normally on here with me or else alone.
Or else the other. Well, we go back and forth.
Yes. Yes. And our special guest today is Rhonda Count. Rhonda is one of the exhibitors in a really terrific show we have right now called Altered Scapes. And I thought she'd like to share some of her experiences with you, as well as some of the wonderful art. We've had so many people comment that this is probably one of the prettiest shows we have ever had. It's amazing.
Thank you for that. We're pleased to be able to have the opportunity to show there, that's for sure. It's a beautiful gallery, and I think it showcases the art very well.
It does. It really does. It's like perfect.
You created such a cohesive exhibit with having how many artists are involved?
There's five of us.
Five. Mm-hmm. You would never, like, only because of mediums would you possibly even recognize that there's so many different artists, it's such a cohesive, beautiful show.
It sort of started with, I think you're familiar with Elaine Solstice. She and I have been wanting to do a show together for quite a while. Mm-hmm. And so kind of looking at the way we kind of do a lot of texture in our paintings, and they've always kind of been themed around nature, landscapes. So the idea of altered scapes was the fact that we have a different view of how we portray landscapes. Mm-hmm. And so we kind of we felt like we complemented each other.
You do.
And so as we were kind of going through the development of the show, Maureen Bowie was one I met at a show down near Kennett Square a few years ago. This is pre-COVID thing. And I invited her. I said, we're looking at doing a show called Altered Scapes. Would you be interested? And she said yes, so kind of brought her into the mix. So they were the three painters. And then we kind of wanted to expand a little bit on the overall kind of viewing pleasure of the show. So I had two very good friends, Linda Rohrbach Osterberry, who's a ceramist, very well known, actually mm-hmm. taught for 30 years and been well known in the sort of Berks County area. And then another good friend of mine, Maxine Rhodes, who is a glass artist, actually now mm-hmm. an instructor at Goggle Works for their studios.
She's good.
She is.
They're all good.
They really are. So it's, as we were hanging the show, one of the things we noticed was there was this kind of universal theme of the orb. Mm-hmm. And Linda's always known for her orbs. Mm-hmm. And I think that it was just kind of interesting how that evolved. And we kind of liked that cohesiveness of the show. And so hanging up was a pleasure.
You've really brought it together.
It really did.
Well, even the postcard carries through that orb.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah. We're very pleased with the postcard. Mm-hmm. We thank the Institute for doing that for us.
Thank Marie.
Marie is excellent.
Well, thank you, Marie.
Marie Zaka.
It's beautiful.
She does a great job.
So, so the five artists are Linda Rohrbach Osterberry, the ceramist. Maureen Bowie is one of the painters. Maxine Rhodes is our glass artist. And Elaine Solstice is another one of the painters, and then myself. So we're showing up through June 30th. We're hoping to have another event there to just bring some people in to meet the artist again. So we're hoping that happens the last week.
And close the show the last week. Good.
Yeah.
They're rather successful when you do it that way.
Yeah, that's what we were. And then, we thought we'd maybe bring in some extra things and that would kind of help too.
There were people that wanted, there were one or two that wanted to take the work. And that was fine.
Mm-hmm.
You can do that as long as it's okay with the artist.
Because we can always, you know, I mean,
replenish.
Elaine sold one. I saw that she, you know, put in two other pieces, and it really works really well. She, you know, again, kind of took into account what was on either side of it, and they look beautiful in there. So,
well, if you let us know ahead of time, if you can get nailed down a date,
we will.
We can at least send it out.
Yeah.
Constant contact.
Okay.
I know that
we have to sort of regroup this week.
The Friday night of your opening is there's a presentation of a 10-minute musicals. The last Friday in July, in June, excuse me, of the 10-minute musicals. So that's that could be something to work with because we like celebrating.
Yeah,
lots
I was going to say yeah.
So that's
I think you had a rehearsal the night that we opened.
Yes,
or not
yes.
rehearsal. I mean,
we had a show.
It was so cute. The little girls running in through the, in their little outfits. It just kind of added to the atmosphere. It was great.
Yeah, the 10-minute musicals. They're a little bit older, but still, it's fun.
Well, that's good.
Yeah.
All right. So again, thank you for the opportunity to show there.
We loved it.
Thank you.
So
thank you.
I was listening this morning on the radio. They were talking about a new study that came out about how visiting galleries and museums actually does all these wonderful things for stress and like, because I guess it takes you away, but there's a whole new study that just was published this morning.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're feeling stressed out, come to Yocum and see the work.
Right. I arrived early this morning and sat in one of the chairs, and it was just very peaceful.
Isn't that a great chair?
It is.
It's like
it
a
is.
Frank Lloyd Wright chair.
Yeah, it's just
the woman that donated.
Inviting.
Her husband was an architect.
Mm. That's nice.
And he passed away, and she said she needed to get them out of her house,
well,
so they
big,
gave them to us.
But they're beautiful.
They're
and
wonderful
comfortable.
In that gallery.
They complement the space, that's for sure.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
nice.
Yes,
yeah.
It does. So do you want to move on and talk about some of the artwork?
Oh, we can if you wanted to.
Yes, I think we have all, you've sent some digital images.
I think the second image, it was just where it has, yes, here it is, the two pieces that, at the waterline, the one on the left is one of my pieces that I actually, again, pre-COVID, it was one of the first ones that kind of I actually called entitled Altered Scapes.
Mm-hmm.
And then Elaine, at the same time, was doing a series on climate change. And so, again, we noticed that there was some similarities going there, and that kind of helped set it. So these two pieces are showing in the gallery. On this. The next one, we actually have a couple of Elaine's pieces, Persuasion and Sargasso Sea. Again, this is part of her series, of her climate change series that she's working on. They're beautiful pieces. There's some people that can control what I call acrylic pours, and I think she's one of the ones that has mastered that. Maureen was the lady I met down at Kennett Square. It's actually called the Unionville High School. It's a fundraiser for that area down there. I met her 3 years ago. We did a show there, and I approached her again for the same reason. I liked her kind of surreal landscapes that she did, and so I invited her to join us for the show. Her pieces really complement. I think the softness of these complements sometimes kind of the hard lines that Elaine and I have. And I like how that works together. And then our other artist, Linda Rohrbach Osterberry, like I said, a wonderful ceramist located in Bartow. The orbs are kind of her signature piece. And what I love about her work is how she incorporated, they need to be seen in 360. You actually have to walk around the piece and get a feel for it, because some of them she'll actually have inscriptions on them on the stories she's telling. So she's very well known for, the orbs are kind of her signature pieces.
She sold several. She sold.
I think she might have sold two so far, but
it's a glass.
They're just, and then Maxine Rhodes, our glass artist.
She sold,
Maxine's a good friend. We've known each other for years. And she started doing glass work about 4 or 5 years ago. Well, actually, she did her stained glass for her home. She's stained glass, and now she's sort of into fused glass. She's actually an instructor at Goggle Works right now. So these were two of her pieces. And again, Forest on the left was a piece that she did a couple years ago when I was thinking about this, and I thought, yes, her work could fit in with it, and just kept adding that other media element that complements the show.
That one was sold.
Yes, yes.
It's interesting knowing Maxine, because I know her through costuming
that's
that
right.
she does.
Yes. With
and mm-hmm. knowing how she works with fibers and mm-hmm. you know and patchwork and mm-hmm. and that seeing her glass sculptures, it just seemed like such a natural evolution.
Yeah, I think she's one of those that's sort of creative in multiple medias.
Yeah,
and I think she's having fun with the glass work.
But it's
right
like
now.
The fluidity of fabric is found in her glass, which
yes.
is not something you always find.
So she's in fabric.
Yeah, she's done the costumes for
costumes
musicals for years.
Or at Wilson West and
okay.
other schools. Yeah,
yeah her yeah, son's a musical director
so
for that, Wilson,
okay.
yeah. Wilson
because
West.
Because we have the textile exhibit coming
yeah.
up.
Yep.
And then my two pieces, the one on the left was one, again, that I did about a year ago. I like working with, I press natural elements from nature. And so it just kind of developing my landscapes and kind of a surreal sort of approach to it. I usually always have the sun or the moon in my pieces. So the one on the right is called The Guardian. And then the one, my most recent piece is called The Mist in the Valley. Again, was just, you have to see these sort of in person. There's a lot, in all of our pieces, there's a lot of texture.
That's a fabulous one, the one on the right.
So
they're both good,
really
good. I love the one on the right.
If you can come to the gallery and see, to just see the texture that's all throughout the show, I think you'll be impressed with
the
feel.
The one on the right, when I first walked into the gallery after the show was hung, it's just, I mean, it's also centered, but it's just striking, and I love the texture. On all the pieces,
thank
there's
you.
Something, you know, you've made the story about the orb, but it's also, it's like you have the juxtaposition of all the texture and the lines in addition to the arcs of the orb, and it's really,
yeah, we were just so pleased
show.
The way it all came together.
It's amazing.
It complements, each complement each other, and who knows, there may be an Alterscape too someday.
Well, you know what, I think that is not a bad idea.
Okay.
Because really, it's a great show.
It really is.
Thank you.
It is. I remember walking in and not knowing which one to go to first because they were all so appealing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But the texture is.
Yeah. I think one of the other things that was a fun element
important.
That we added was there's the one wall where all the small pieces are.
Mm-hmm.
I ordered the frames and passed them out. So we each had like two or three that we could incorporate in any way we wanted to. So there was kind of that cohesive wall of smaller works.
The one on the end.
The one on the end.
When you walk in, it's the first.
Yeah, the one straight ahead.
Yeah,
directly in
front. Your pieces I was eyeing and I saw it was sold yesterday and I was like, oh.
I was surprised
that
I saw it this morning. So, so we've all sold some pieces and that makes it, a positive show too for the artists.
Yes.
So
So I think when you do a closing, you might be surprised.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Sounds good.
Yeah.
We look forward to it.
Well, we look forward to it too.
All right. I'll get to work on that this week.
That's really better. If you can work on it, get it to me because I'm supposed to be out of town next week, but I'm available.
Okay. I'll let you know.
I can be reached. It's not a big deal.
But Susan is going out of town and already has planning.
Well, because something about a grant was sent to me today saying I'll have it the end of the week and I'm leaving Saturday. Okay.
Yeah.
It'll give me something to do. Nothing else to do but review it.
Nothing else to do except relax somewhere. Come on, Susan.
If I get it, I can relax with the grant and the beach.
You should relax in the gallery looking at the artwork. So you
That's
go to the beach to work. Is that how that works?
I don't know. It's hard to relax in the gallery looking at the artwork. There's always somebody that finds you. You know that.
Yes, yes. The ongoing joke that you and I need little bells around our necks in that building.
And then our next show after Rhonda's closes, after Alterscapes, opens July 14th. It's a textile show. It's called Unraveled. And I think it'll be quite interesting because we're not quite sure how this one's coming together, but we have seven artists and they are interesting. It's going to be a lot of clothing. It's textiles. Mm-hmm. There's clothing, there's wall hangings. It's going to be quite
another texture based show.
Lots of texture for textiles. Yeah. Unraveled is what we're becoming, trying to put it together.
That's a good
to
title.
Be honest with you.
Well, there's also like being in there's like this need for all of us to like touch and feel and be in person that's you were all coming out of. So
yes.
It's interesting that we're gravitating towards these like mm-hmm. touchy feely texture, you know, as opposed to the one a photo exhibit.
But make
for
sure
example.
Your hands are clean if you're going to
touch.
Well,
you're not going to actually touch. Just, you know, just feeling.
Some people do. They even touch the painting, so I go because it's. They can't help themselves. They know better.
Oh,
they go
I,
to do
people
it.
People ask me all the time, do you mind if I touch it? And I say, you know, it's acrylic. You're pretty safe. I
right.
say, yes, go ahead. So then, you know.
They're just,
but
yeah.
it's all, a compliment in a way to if they want to touch. But.
And the kids walk, not in the gallery, but uh-huh. walking through the hallways every day. It's don't touch the paintings. Because they
painting.
All just, like, you
oh,
do.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
you just, we
well,
kind of
most
know.
Of the ones, well, in the hall.
The
ones
that
have
touch.
Glass.
Yeah.
Or something mm-hmm. on to protect it. But
no,
the ones on the other side don't.
It's the giant Pollock inspired one that they all
want. It's the Barton.
No. The one that was done with Camps over the years that's hanging across from our offices. The kids always wanted to
touch. Oh, that one. That big one.
Yes.
Yeah, the kids did that.
Yes, they did. So they're allowed to touch it.
Yeah.
They did it. Well, what a segue, Susan.
Yeah, what a segue into, yes, into our next big event. Mm-hmm. Or it's running now.
Yeah, our summer camp started
a lot
yesterday.
Of things coming up. Beverly's really busy. Camp started yesterday.
Yes.
And we have a lot more things coming up, events and
yes.
performances.
So first summer camps started yesterday. We have bugging out this week, and we had guests from Noldy Forest come, and the kids, you know, learned the whole, you know, all insects are bugs, but not all bugs are insects. That's how it goes. So that's part of what they're learning. And so to that end, a worm can be considered a bug. Mm-hmm. It's not an insect, but it is a bug, so it's a crawly thing. And so they, yesterday they got to, touch real ones and dissect a gummy worm and then use spaghetti to paint.
So they love the gummy worms.
Gummy
that's
worm.
What
that's
they
a
told
great
me.
Idea. That's a great
yeah,
idea.
That was a big hit.
Yes. Like first that. Day of camp, we sugar them up. That was great.
That's
really
cool. yeah.
thoughtful
Keeps
of us.
Them. Yeah. Not to hum to your parents, you're all pumped up with sugar.
One gummy worm, I think they're okay.
They're all right.
But we have a lot of really exciting camps coming up. Next week is our Artventions Young Engineers, and that's why I said about a segue, because Rich is going
to, Rich, yeah.
Rich Houck is the lead teacher for that. So we're excited to bring him back to Yocum to work with that camp. We also have the Young Performers that we were talking about that comes in a couple of weeks. And there are still some spots, not a lot, but there are still some spaces left in Broadway Junior, which is our, hold on, let me see, I actually have some images here for this, so let's find one that is the right image that I'm not finding. of course, because I'm looking for it. But Broadway Junior is Spamalot, Monty Python Spamalot, and there is a G-rated version that exists of Monty Python's work.
That's great.
Are kids aware of Monty Python of this age?
The
parents are. But.
The parents are. It's been really popular with the 10 and uppers.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Because they do know it from their parents.
Hmm.
And it's a lot of fun. And then we have our picture book camps. Anyway, camps are underway. You can find all the information on our website. What we're also really excited and gearing up for is for our productions, that we have our whole season mm-hmm. laid out, and that launches actually the weekend of the 25th with the Mad Tea Party. June 25th at Gring's Mill, we're going to be performing the Mad Tea Party. That is a group. Yocum does shows that are young performers and then shows that are mixed ages. This is definitely a mixed age production, most definitely. It's a really fun idea where Time finally released the Mad Hatter from their never-ending tea, and so they're having a tea to celebrate time releasing them, and then some things go wrong and they have to figure it out. And it's at Grings Mill in the amphitheater. If it rains, we'll be in the barn. And I need to give a shout out, thank you to Arethusa Designs and Jeff Cassano for helping us with sound, because sound outdoors is its own lovely
challenge.
Yes. Challenge. And then also touring, we have...
Now you may have some of the performers at Art in the Avenue on the 18th,
potentially,
possibly.
Yes, yes. We have to kind of, this is, you know, the world of productions, you have to make sure you have everything.
Right.
Ready, and the show does open in.
But they may be there with GRAT.
They might be there.
Greater
they might
Reading
be
Alliance.
There with the Greater Reading Theater.
Alliance of Community Theaters.
Yes.
Which we are a member of.
Yes, we are. And their costumes and photo ops of with the Mad Hatter. No Alice. Alice isn't in this one. It's everybody
it's just
else.
Just everybody else.
And then we also just started rehearsals for our Rainbow Fish Library Tour that is going to all 24 libraries in the county, public libraries. This has a cast of, I have a graphic up for that if you can bring it up. That is a five roles. We have a cast of nine that rotate through because it is, you know, 26 performances inside of 2 weeks. So that's a lot. It's wonderful. We're excited.
And that is funded by the Bartlett Foundation.
Yes. Thank you, Bartlett Foundation. Thank you,
yes.
Thank you, thank you. Mm-hmm. And then also the next thing that is a camp program is Don't Blame Me on the Playwright. This is an image from a similar camp a few years ago that Joel Gorey is directing, and it is really hilarious. It's about a couple of playwrights that they finally get their big break on Broadway, and the producer has all these ideas of how they could fix their show and keep sending in different types of writers to fix it. So they have to go through all these different genres, from like normal, like realistic, into over the top musical, into like a telenova kind of thing. So it's a great fun thing for the kids to do. And this one is Young Performers, and it's in August. And then we have, I'm going to start switching graphics here. So then we have, let's see. Oh my goodness, we have so many things. So we have the Pose on Happy Hour. We're going to be booking, sending information out to schools for booking information for Pose on Happy Hour. And
that's in October, though.
That's in October.
Right.
Yeah, but if it's our whole season, then I'll keep going.
Right.
And then we have, I'm trying to jam it all in, Susan. Carnival of the Animals, we're doing with the Reading Philharmonic, also in October. They'll perform at the Reading Public Library, the main branch, and then they come to us, and we're gonna partner that with our Neighborhood Bridges program and have them write some poems so that, although we're using, I'm forgetting that Saint, oh my goodness, I can't think of his name. The person that wrote it. Anyway, we use some of his poetry, but then also we have the kids write new poetry about the animals.
And the Neighborhood Bridges program is something that's in the Reading School District that
right.
we run
right.
in partnership with the classroom teachers.
My goodness.
And then going to our intergenerational Everybody Show, we're so excited. We're doing a Christmas story. I can't wait.
Yeah, that'll
you know,
be fun.
The good old Ralphie and Don't Shoot Your Eye Out.
When are auditions?
They're coming up. They are definitely coming up. So that's our December piece. And then our big cornerstone piece for the Children's Theater Festival that we're bringing back is Go Dog Go, which we did years and like over 10 years ago.
Yeah, we did it a long time ago.
Yeah, but it's live, it has an accordion accompanist.
Live music.
Live music from the book. So much fun. This is the adult performers, professional performers show that we do. We also have The Boy at the Edge of Everything that's coming up after that. And then I'm gonna switch us to Little Women here, which I'm really looking forward to. Little Women, this is Kate Hamill's version of Little Women. So it's a little more contemporary. Andrea Hart is gonna be directing that. And we're really looking forward, that's in May of 2023. And then to kick off Pride Month, which we're in now, so we're looking a year ahead, we're working with the LGBT Center of Greater Reading, and we're going to be doing Head Over Heels. This is a romp through the woods adventure based on the play Arcadia. So it's that coming of age prince, princess kind of thing, right, with the magical witch. But it's all set to music of the Go-Go's, and
and how much it's, fun! Can we play?
Yes, yes, please. And it's very, very gender bending, so it's perfect for Pride Month, and we're really excited about that partnership with them.
That's fantastic.
And then we have our great big extravaganza at Grings Mill at the same time as 1 year after Mad Tea Party, Wonderland, Be Curious. That we're doing with partnership in a lot of different theater and organizations, but also part of GRACT. So
right. So it's,
did I get it out? And have a big
every
year.
Month, pretty much. Uh-huh. That you have some event.
Pretty much. Yes. And then there's Jazz on the Avenue concerts thrown in there too.
Thrown in there, yeah. Just
they're in there September, October, November.
Yeah, and John's working on some good artists for us too.
Well, so. I hope.
Yeah,
I haven't seen them yet, but I need to know.
I believe him.
Soon.
He is.
He'll get it done.
Well, and we're going to do the Boy at the Edge of Everything as a jazz fest for kids.
Right.
So,
that should be fun.
I'm very
and creative
excited.
And fun.
Boy at the Edge of Everything, I have been wanting to bring to Yocum
for a long time.
Since 2016.
Right.
Yeah, so I'm really excited about that one.
So, I think that about sums up kind of what we're doing.
And
next month will be more things
so
to talk about.
Wendy actually breathed this year.
And I think they're telling us we need to say goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you. See you next month.
Thank you.
Thank you.
'The Institute Presents' on BCTV is supported by the Yocum Family Perpetual Charitable Trust.